Wages Against Housework by Silvia Federici. A Labor of Love. It is important to recognize that when we speak of housework, we are not speaking of a job as other jobs, but we are speaking of the most pervasive manipulation, the most subtle and mystified violence that capitalism has ever perpetrated against any section of the working class. True, under capitalism, every worker is manipulated and exploited, and his or her relation to the capital is totally mystified. The wage gives the impression of a fair deal. You work and you get paid, hence you and your boss are equal. While in reality, the wage, rather than paying for the work you do, hides all the unpaid work that goes into profit. But the wage at least recognizes that you are a worker, and you can bargain and struggle around and against the terms and the quantity of that wage, the terms and the quantity of that work. To have a wage means to be a part of social contract. And there is no doubt concerning its meaning. You work not because you like it or because it comes naturally to you, but because it is the only condition under which you are allowed to live. But exploited as you might be, you are not that work. Today you are a postman, tomorrow a cab driver. All that matters is how much of that work you have to do and how much of that money you can get. But in the case of housework, that situation is qualitatively different. The difference lies in the fact that not only has housework been imposed on women, but it has been transformed into a natural attribute of our female physique and personality, an internal need, an aspiration, supposedly coming from the depth of our female character. Housework had to be transformed into a natural attribute rather than be recognized as a social contract, because from the beginning of the capital scheme for women, this work was destined to be unwaged. Capital had to convince us that it is a natural, unavoidable, and even fulfilling activity to make us accept our unwaged work. In its turn, the unwaged condition of housework has been the most powerful weapon in reinforcing the common assumption that housework is not work, thus preventing women from struggling against it, except in the privatized kitchen-bedroom quarrel that all society agrees to ridicule, thereby further reducing the protagonist of a struggle. We are seen as nagging bitches, not workers in struggle. Yet, just how natural it is to be a housewife is shown by the fact that it takes at least 20 years of socialization, day-to-day training performed by an unwaged mother to prepare a woman for this role, to convince her that children and husband are the best she can expect from life. Even so, it hardly succeeds. No matter how well trained we are, few are the women who do not feel cheated when the bride's day is over and they find themselves in front of a dirty sink. Many of us still have the illusion that we marry for love. A lot of us recognize that we marry for money and security, but it is time to make it clear that while the love or money involved is very little, the work which awaits us is enormous. This is why older women always tell us, enjoy your freedom while you can, buy whatever you want now. But unfortunately, it is almost impossible to enjoy any freedom if, from the earliest day of life, you are trained to be docile, subservient, dependent, and most important, to sacrifice yourself, and even to get pleasure from it. If you don't like it, it is your problem, your failure, your guilt, your abnormality. We must admit that capital has been very successful in hiding our work. It has created a true masterpiece at the expense of women. by denying housework a wage and transforming it into an act of love, capital has killed many birds with one stone. First of all, it has got a hell of a lot of work almost for free, and it has made sure that women, far from struggling against it, would seek that work as the best thing in life. The magic words, "Yes, darling, you are a real woman." At the same time, it has disciplined the male worker also by making his woman dependent on his work and his wage, and trapped him in this discipline by giving him a servant after he himself has done so much serving at the factory or the office. In fact, our role as women is to be the unwaged but happy and the most of all loving servants of all the working class. That is, those strata of the proletariat to which capital was forced to grant more social power. In the same way as God created Eve to give pleasure to Adam, so did capital create the housewife to service the male worker physically, emotionally, and sexually, to raise his children, mend his socks, patch up his ego when it is crushed by the work and the social relations, which are relations of loneliness that capital has reserved for him. It is precisely that peculiar combination of physical, emotional, and sexual services that are involved in the role women must perform for capital that creates the specific character of that servant, which is the housewife, that makes her work so burdensome and at the same time invisible. It is not an accident that most men start thinking of getting married as soon as they get their first job. This is not only because now they can afford it, but because having someone at home who takes care of you is the only condition not to go crazy after a day spent on an assembly line or at a desk. Every woman knows that this is what she should be doing to be a true woman and have a successful marriage. In this case too, the poorer the family, the higher the enslavement of the woman, and not simply because of the monetary situation. In fact, capital has a dual policy, one for the middle class and one for the proletarian family. It is no accident that we find the most unsophisticated machismo in the working class family. The more blows the man gets at work, the more his wife must be trained to absorb them, the more he is allowed to recover his ego at her expense. You beat your wife and vent your rage against her when you are frustrated or overtired by your work, or when you are defeated in a struggle. To go into a factory is itself a defeat. The more the man serves and is bossed around, the more he bosses around. A man's home is his castle, and his wife has to learn to wait in silence when he's moody, to put him back together when he's broken down and swears at the world, to turn around in bed when he says, "I'm too tired tonight," or when he goes so fast at lovemaking that, as one woman put it, he might as well make it with a mayonnaise jar. Women have always found ways of fighting back or getting back at them, but always in an isolated and privatized way. The problem then becomes how to bring this struggle out of the kitchen and bedroom and into the streets. This fraud that goes under the name of love and marriage affects all of us, even if we are not married, because once housework was totally naturalized and sexualized, once it became a feminine attribute, all of us as females are characterized by it. If it is natural to do certain things, then all women are expected to do them, and even like doing them. Even those women who, due to their social position, could escape some of that work, or most of it. Their husbands can afford maids and shrinks and other forms of relaxation and amusement. We might not serve one man, but we are all in a servant relation with respect to the whole male world. This is why to be called a female is such a put-down, such a degrading thing. "Smile, honey. What's the matter with you?" is something every man feels entitled to ask you, whether he is your husband or the man who takes your ticket, or your boss at work. The revolutionary perspective. If we start from this analysis, we can see the revolutionary implications of the demand for wages for housework. It is the demand by which our nature ends and our struggle begins, because just to want wages for housework means to refuse that work as the expression of our nature. And therefore, to use precisely the female role that capital has invented for us. To ask for wages for housework will by itself undermine the expectations society has of us, since these expectations, the essence of our socialization, are all functional to our wageless condition in the home. In this sense, it is absurd to compare the struggle of women for wages to the struggle of male workers in the factory for more wages. The waged worker, in struggling for more wages, challenges his social role, but remains within it. When we struggle for wages, we struggle unambiguously and directly against our social role. In the same way, there is a qualitative difference between the struggles of the waged worker and the struggles of the slave for a wage against that slavery. It should be clear, however, that when we struggle for a wage, we do not struggle to enter capitalist relations, because we have never been out of them. We struggle to break capital's plan for women, which is an essential moment of that planned division of labor and social power within the working class, through which capital has been able to maintain its power. Wages for housework, then, is a revolutionary demand, not because by itself it destroys capital, but because it attacks capital and forces it to restructure social relations in terms more favorable to us and consequently more favorable to the unity of the class. In fact, to demand wages for housework does not mean to say that if we are paid, we will continue to do it. It means precisely the opposite. To say that we want money for housework, it is the first step towards refusing to do it, because the demand for a wage makes our work visible, which is the most indispensable condition to begin to struggle against it, both in its immediate aspect as housework and its more insidious character as femininity. Against any accusation of economism, we should remember that money is capital. That is, it is the power to command labor. Therefore, to reappropriate that money which is the fruit of our labor, of our mothers' and grandmothers' labor, means at the same time to undermine capital's power to command forced labor from us. And we should not distrust the power of the wage in demystifying our femaleness and making visible our work. Our femaleness as work, since the lack of a wage has been so powerful in shaping this role and hiding our work. To demand wages for housework is to make it visible that our minds, bodies, and emotions have all been distorted for a specific function, in a specific function, and then have them thrown back at us as a model to which we should all conform if we want to be accepted as women in this society. To say that we want wages for housework is to expose the fact that housework is already money for capital. That capital has made and makes money out of our cooking, smiling, fucking. At the same time, it shows that we have cooked, smiled, and fucked throughout the years, not because it was easier for us than for anybody else, but because we did not have any other choice. Our faces have become distorted from so much smiling. Our feelings have got lost from so much loving. Our over-sexualization has left us completely desexualized. Wages for housework is only the beginning, but its message is clear. From now on, they have to pay us because, as females, we do not guarantee anything any longer. We want to call work what is work, so that eventually we might rediscover what is love and create what will be our sexuality, which we have never known. And from this viewpoint of work, we can ask not one wage, but many wages, because we have been forced into many jobs at once. We are housemaids, prostitutes, nurses, shrinks. This is the essence of the heroic spouse who is celebrated on Mother's Day. We say, stop celebrating our exploitation, our supposed heroism. From now on, we want money for each moment of it, so we can refuse some of it and eventually all of it. In this respect, nothing can be more effective than to show that our female virtues have a calculable money value, until today only for capital, increased in the measure that we were defeated. From now on, against capital for us, in the measure we organize our power.